Hello and welcome to this lesson. In this lesson, I'm going to cover some of the fundamentals of cloud computing and what the benefits of cloud computing are. And then I'm going to go into Amazon Web Services, AWS, giving you a high-level overview of the AWS cloud and some of the features and pricing models and how we can actually manage services in AWS. I'm going to start off by comparing some of the traditional non-cloud services that you might be familiar with to their counterparts in the cloud. So for example, here we have an email server. So back in the day, and some companies still do this, but back in the day, many companies I worked with would have their own email server. So I would often be the one setting up their email servers, and you had to deploy a lot of infrastructure in different parts of the world if it was a global organization, set up all the mail routing. It was quite a job. Many companies today choose instead to utilize a cloud service like Gmail or Microsoft Office 365. Then we've got file servers. Of course, many companies still use file servers today. There's lots of use cases for that, but there are counterparts in the cloud like Dropbox, for example. And of course, Gmail with G Drive, they have their own as well, as do Microsoft and many other big companies. And then we've got customer relationship management systems. These are certainly less popular on premises these days because most companies prefer to use a cloud-based service like Salesforce.com instead. Now, some of the characteristics of the cloud services are firstly, you don't own or manage the infrastructure on which the service runs. Now that can significantly reduce the capital expenditure because this infrastructure, these servers, the networking, the storage systems, all of the different components that it takes to deliver these types of services on premises do cost a lot of money. That's a lot of capital, a lot of cash that the company might not want to give away. And then of course, there's all that maintenance and management that you have to do. Also, cloud services are usually on a subscription or consumption model. Again, moving away from that capital expenditure, large amounts of cash, and instead spending money on a monthly basis based on either a fixed subscription rate or consumption, so actually how much you use that month. Also, services in the cloud will typically scale automatically as demand changes. So if you have a big spike in traffic, then the cloud service should scale automatically along with that demand. And of course, you'll pay appropriately for the extra services that you used. Now, there are various different types of cloud, but they all should share the same key characteristics. And I'll just cover these off very quickly. So firstly, they should be on demand and self-service. That means there should be a capability where users of the cloud, the consumers of the cloud, are able to go into some kind of self-service portal or catalog and actually choose which services they want to use. And those services should then be delivered automatically without any human intervention at all. We then have broad network access. So most cloud services will be accessible over the internet using standard protocols that we're used to, like for example, HTTP. So in some cases, you might be connected to a cloud using private networks. That's okay, either a VPN or a private connection. But at the same time, usually most of the public cloud services, all the hyperscale providers, for example, they all provide public access to their APIs. So we'll talk more about that later. Next up, you have resource pooling. All this means is that the cloud service provider have aggregated a large capacity of compute, storage, networking, all of the underlying infrastructure that is required to deliver the cloud service. And then they allow multiple tenants, in other words, the customers, to utilize that infrastructure with security isolation between them, of course. The next characteristic is rapid elasticity. So as I mentioned before, most cloud services should scale automatically based on demand. So as you get more demand for your application, the underlying infrastructure is going to scale so that your service has more resources to use. And then when you don't need those resources, they're going to be given back again. And that brings us to the last point, the measured service, because you should only be paying for what you actually use. And that, of course, means that there should be some kind of itemized bill where you can see the various different components of your bill, how much you used, what the rate for that service was, and then your total amount. So those are the key characteristics. Now you can build your own cloud, and if it has all of these characteristics, then that's what we would call a private cloud. So in other words, you might build this in your data center. I've built lots of these for customers. I can tell you it's very complex and very expensive, but occasionally there are use cases where this is beneficial to a company. So here we have a virtualization cluster. We have storage and backup systems. We've got network and firewall systems. But then on top of that, we have to add on those capabilities. So we need the self-service. We need the service catalog. We need the service automation. We need orchestration. So everything is automated in terms of the delivery of the service. Monitoring and logging so we know what's going on. Billing and reporting so that we can charge the customers. Multi-tenancy so that we can have multiple customers. And if you're within a company building a private cloud, those customers might not be other companies. They could be different companies within a group of companies, or they could just simply be different business units within your company. And then we've got other things like configuration management, lifecycle management, security and identity, and so on. Now, of course, all of this comes with quite a significant cost. We've got the data center itself. You've got the security services. You've got power. You've got connectivity. You've got physical hardware, software licensing, and maintenance contracts. And then, of course, you've got staff costs, lots of operations and management. So building a private cloud is quite an expensive exercise, and often you still don't get the capabilities that you might get from a public provider like AWS. So what is the public cloud? So the public cloud, and of course an example here, is Amazon Web Services, but there are others like Microsoft Azure and Google Cloud Platform as well. But it's basically a cloud that is accessible to the public. So you as an individual or your company can come along with a credit card, set up an account, and start utilizing those cloud services. Now, if you're a company, you will typically have some kind of office or maybe a data center if you've got your own systems. And you can then connect to that public cloud, either just directly over the internet, or you can set up a private connection or a VPN over the internet. And then you can start deploying services like compute, storage, network, and databases in the cloud. And there's many, many more different types of service on AWS. So the benefits of this model, you have a variable expense instead of a capital expense. So you're paying on a monthly basis for what you use. There are exceptions to that. AWS does have some larger discounts if you lock in for a year or 3 years. But other than that, most services are available on a monthly expenditure where you're just paying for what you use. You've got economies of scale. So AWS are huge. They've got hundreds of thousands of customers all over the world. They invest very heavily both in their platforms and in the software that sits on top of it, all of those services that they build. So that provides economies of scale, which means they can reduce the cost of those services to you as the end consumer. And you get massive elasticity. AWS are huge. They have such a massive amount of compute power that it's very rare that they're going to run out. There's usually always some capacity somewhere. And so even the biggest companies with the largest requirements don't have an issue scaling in the cloud. And as I mentioned, other examples would be Microsoft Azure and Google Cloud Platform as well. AWS is by far the leader in this space. Azure come in second place and Google Cloud Platform a little way behind that. Now, there's a few different service models in the cloud. The first one is private cloud. We just had a look at that. That's where you build it yourself. Now, if you build it yourself, not only do you have that big capital expenditure, but of course you have to manage it. All the responsibility is on you. Then we have what we call infrastructure as a service, or IaaS. This is where essentially you have managed virtual machines. So if you understand virtualization, essentially it just means that you have virtual servers running an operating system like Linux or Windows, and everything underneath that operating system is managed for you. Then we've got platform as a service, which is another level up. It means less overhead for you in terms of management. Now you just bring your code. And lastly, software as a service. So here, everything is managed for you. You know, going back to salesforce.com or email services like Gmail. That's a SaaS service because everything is managed for you. You have very limited scope, though, in terms of what you can do to modify the platform. So let's look at these side by side. On the left-hand side here, you've got the private cloud. So here, everything is managed for you. We saw before that there's lots of software layers, which I'm not showing on this screen as well. So you have to manage everything. With infrastructure as a service, you can see here the server layer, including all the associated storage and networking, and the hypervisor are managed for you. So now you have these virtual machines, these VMs just sitting on top. In the cloud, we also call them instances. So what you have to manage if you're using IaaS is the operating system, so Windows or Linux, and you have to manage all the updates, for example, the software updates, then any application frameworks that you're using, and then your data, of course, and then your application itself. If you go to platform as a service, you lose some of that responsibility. So you give it away, you outsource it to someone else. So now all you're doing is bringing your data and your code for your application. Everything underneath it is managed. And then lastly, of course, we have that SaaS service where you basically don't have much responsibility, but also it means you have less control. You're losing control as you give this away, moving from where you have that, you know, larger expense and larger complexity on the private cloud on the left-hand side through to a SaaS service on the right where you no longer have to worry about a lot of stuff, but of course you have less scope to modify it or customize it to your own requirements. Okay, so let's look at Amazon Web Services, AWS. So they are what's known as a hyperscale public cloud provider. They've got well over 200 services. I don't give exact numbers because it changes all the time. Occasionally they decommission a service, usually with a good bit of notification, usually about a year or so. But mostly it's just about increasing that number because they're constantly adding new services all the time. In terms of market leadership and growth, they are the leading cloud service provider with by far the largest market share. And they have global infrastructure. So that means they've got data centers and infrastructure equipment within those data centers all over the world. And we'll look a bit more into detail on that in a moment. In terms of innovation and expansion, AWS is known for rapid pace of innovation. It's hard to keep up sometimes because they are constantly innovating, changing things, improving them, and releasing new services. So let's have a look at the global infrastructure at a high level. So around the world, AWS has regions, and these are essentially separate physical locations in the world. There are many of them around the world. Again, the number increases all the time, so I'm not going to give you an exact number. So you can see here we've got US East, we've got EU West, and we've got AP Southeast. Now, each region consists of multiple availability zones. You can see in the diagram here, we have three availability zones in each region. Now, some regions will have more than that. An availability zone is essentially one or more separate data centers. Okay, so it's at least one separate data center. So for most purposes, I just consider each availability zone to be a data center, but it could be more than one data center. And AWS don't tell us that. They don't release that level of information. All of these regions are connected with a network known as the AWS Global Network. And that's a highly redundant network with very good bandwidth and low latency. So how do we go and manage AWS services? There's a few different ways. We're going to look at those now. The first one is the management console. This is a graphical user interface accessed via a web browser. And from there, we can find many services. You can see some examples here. On the left-hand side, these are just the categories of service. And then on the right-hand side, we're just seeing a snippet of the ones that start with the letter A. There's obviously a lot of services here. The next option we have, if we don't want to use the graphical user interface, is the command line. With the CLI, we can run simple commands like this one to launch a virtual server in the cloud. Or this one here will list the contents of a storage container that's called a bucket on the Amazon S3 service. The CLI is a utility that you can install on your computer, whether you're on Windows, Linux, or Mac. You can also run CLI commands in the cloud on AWS as well, using a service called AWS Cloud Shell. Lastly, we have programmatic management. Here we're using a software development kit, and there are several different software development kits for different programming languages. For example, we've got Boto Free for Python. So a developer will write code in an integrated development environment, an IDE, or some similar tool, and then you can package that code, and that code is able to speak to the API on AWS. So basically, anything that you want to do in the cloud, you can do either through the management console, the command line interface, or if you're a developer, you can leverage one of the software development kits. So you can see we have a huge amount of power here, and we can perform this management using one of these different methods from anywhere in the world over the internet. Okay, so that's it for this lesson. Just a brief overview of cloud computing in AWS, and we're going to get into a lot more detail in subsequent lessons.